Welcome to the first YouTube debate. My name is William Such and I'll be moderating. Our topic is the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, the Ukrainian Insurgent Army, Jews and Ukrainians. And our panel guests are Mr. Askold Luzinski, an attorney in New Jersey and former president of the Ukrainian World Congress. We also have Professor John Paul Himka from the Department of History at the University of Alberta. Gentlemen, thank you both kindly for joining.
You're welcome.
I have taped interviews with both of you separately, and the purpose of this debate is to bring you together to highlight and examine the differences between those who maintain that the Oun and Upa deserve a revered place in Ukrainian history and those who caution that these organizations at best shouldn't be glorified and at worst may be guilty of war crimes. So Mr. Luzinski, I'll begin with you. What is your position?
My position is that the Oun Upa is indispensable to understanding Ukrainian history of the 20th century. They're crucial in the sense that they're a major part of national awareness and nation building. I often use a phrase that without Oun Upa, Ukraine would in all likelihood be like Belarus. And Ukraine has had a number of problems in terms of its identity because its history over the years has been savage. And Upa, Oun Upa, is very important for that history. This is a history that did not end in 1953 when apparently the last forces of the Upa were destroyed. But it's a history that survived and is very relevant today. The book by Leonid Plush, Internationalism or Russification, he makes a number of references to the Banderuchi, as they're called, but he uses one in particular that in 1963 there was a march in Kyiv, the capital of Ukraine, to honor the memory of Ivan Franko. And it was organized by the Ukrainian Writers Union. And they were speaking Ukrainian, that's it. And the people along Khreshchatyk that were witnessing this specifically were heard to say, look at those Banderuchi, there are so many of them. The title Banderuchi essentially does not necessarily refer to Stepan Bandera. It's a nom de guerre for all Ukrainians, at least as far as the Ukrainian enemy is concerned. My position vis-a-vis Oun Upa during the Second World War is that Oun Upa were not collaborating with the Nazis. They were certainly not a fascist organization. They were not even anti-Semitic because, frankly, I don't even know what anti-Semitism means because today that label is almost everywhere. Anyone who criticizes Israel is considered an anti-Semite. On the other hand, much of these disparaging items that come from many sources, and even in this case from the Holocaust industry, comes as a result of Mr. Himka's work. He is perceived as a, unfortunately, self-loathing Ukrainian. He is perceived as someone who is a hired gun, if you will, having done very little or no work on the subject of the Holocaust until very recently, meaning some 8-9 years ago, and only beginning to do this work when he was given the opportunity through financial resources and given an opportunity to smear the Oun Upa. His tactic, in my opinion, is to sling mud and hope that some of it will stick. He reaches, despite being a historian and frankly probably a scholar, although I don't know that much of his work, he has reached a conclusion and then he goes out and searches for evidence, so-called evidence, to back his conclusion as opposed to the other way around, doing research and on the basis of that research to reach a conclusion.
Okay, I thought we were supposed to answer our attitudes towards the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists and the Ukrainian Insurgent Army and not run down other people. And I would like if we could stay on subject, and I will respond to some of the things also that Mr. Lozinski said about me. But first of all, on the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists and UPA. During the war, and actually preparing for the war, Baun and UPA adopted a much more virulent anti-Semitism than they had had previously. During the war, the militia of Oun collaborated with the Germans in the violence of the summer of 1941, consisting of pogroms, roundups for executions, and massive beatings of the Jewish population, as well as occasional murders of Jews in specific villages. All of this is well documented. Then after the militia was destroyed or dissolved by the Nazis and replaced with the Ukrainian Auxiliary Police, numerous members of the former militia went into the police. Oun urged people, urged their followers to go into the Ukrainian Auxiliary Police. And this Ukrainian Auxiliary Police was one of the most important instruments of the Holocaust in Western Ukraine, in both Galicia and Volhynia. Furthermore, when the policemen were done, Oun called upon them to desert and join the Ukrainian Insurgent Army, about 5,000 of these policemen did that. They launched an ethnic cleansing against the Polish population, during which time they also killed any Jews who were hiding with Poles, or actually any Jews they just found routinely in their work. And then in the winter of 1943-44, they actually lured Jews out of the bunkers and slaughtered them. They also, in the course of their fight against collectivization, killed, according to the accounts we have from Soviet documents, about 17,000 peasants. So these were people who were involved in collective farms. This all falls into the category of war criminality. It is an unfortunate thing, and it was not unusual at that time in Eastern Europe that anti-Soviet formations would become infected with the views of National Socialism and of fascism, which were very popular at that time, from Spain all the way through to Lithuania and Poland. So this is not unusual. Mr. Lozinski said that without Oun UPA, Ukraine would be like Belarus. I look at it a little differently. A lot of the people in Ukraine look upon these people as fascists and as on the wrong side in World War II. Their grandfathers fought on the side of the Red Army. The Bandera group fought against the Red Army, and sometimes, both in 1941 until at least September, and again when they made a truce in 1944, briefly, well, not that briefly, with the Germans, they were collaborators with the Germans. I'm going to just say a few things about me. I'm not a hired gun. I've been a Ukrainian historian for a long time. I have a lot of works to my credit, not just on the Holocaust. I received money to do research from Canada Council. I received $45,000. I received $11,200 to work at the Holocaust Museum from the Mark and Pincus Wiesen Fellowship. Perhaps I'm working for the Canadians, Mr. Lozinski. I did not start working on the Holocaust very recently. My first publication is in 1988 on the Holocaust, and there are others one that follow, starting in the late 1990s. So it's not just recently. However, I have not made it the major source of the major focus of my research until I finished my work on Last Judgment iconography in 2007. How did I get into it? I got into it because I've always been interested in Ukrainian modern Ukrainian history. I was not working in that area originally. My first publication from about 1988 appeared in Monthly Review, and it was the memoirs of a Ukrainian Marxist who was put into Auschwitz for helping Jews in Kraków. Afterwards, I was called to write for studies in European Jewry, a very important publication. They said they're looking for someone to write about the Ukrainian issue of collaboration in the Holocaust. Could I do it? I said, well, I've collected various notes, but I haven't actually ever done any research. I got money from my university. I was able to go to Jerusalem for a week and to Yibo for a week, and I wrote my first sort of studied article on the basis of that. I would also say this, that until sometime in the late 1980s, I was a defender of UNUPA, and I thought that they would be helping the Jews during the war. And what I discovered was that was not the case. Finally, a Polish friend of mine said, really, you should revise your views. Then I began to study it from the archives. First of all, from my father-in-law's archives. He was the editor of a Ukrainian newspaper under German rule, Krakivsky Vesti. I looked into his files, and I wrote two articles already on the basis of those files about Ukrainian anti-Semitism during the war. So I have a bit of a history here. I've done a lot of research.
There is there was a Congress of the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, which was held in April of 1941, some 2 months prior to the war. At that Congress, a number of resolutions were adopted. One of the resolutions, and it was number 17 on the agenda, interestingly enough, it was number 17 amongst political resolutions, so certainly not a priority resolution, which is often cited by Mr. Himka and others who disparage UNUPA. However, they don't cite the resolution to its very end. The resolution states pretty much that the Jews were the underpinning of Bolshevism, and that's the portion of the resolution that Mr. Himka and his people, they cite. However, the resolution goes on to say the following. It says, but Ukrainians should not be misled. Ukrainians have to recognize that the enemy is Moscow. This resolution and others have often been taken by as an example of the fact, and Mr. Himka acknowledges this in his document, in his essay on the Lviv pogroms, that Oun was opposed to pogroms. And his argument regarding what transpired in Lviv in 1941, in July of 1941, was that somehow the Germans had convinced them that if you follow suit, if you work with us, we will recognize Ukrainian independence. But there is a memorandum some 2 weeks prior to July 1st, 1941, that was delivered by the UN to Hitler or Hitler's people, in which they state unequivocally that we in this particular instance, welcome your appearance as an actor in this particular struggle. However, if you fail to recognize an independent Ukrainian state, and if you go against it, then you will find that Ukrainians are your worst enemies. There isn't a single document which can be found among the documents of the OUN archives, except for purported documents which were found in Soviet archives. Amazingly enough, these documents that have been found that allegedly they incriminate UN, and they don't necessarily incriminate UN. They suggest that UN was responsible or was suggestive or was instrumental in forming the Ukrainian militia and the auxiliary police. That's all it says, all right? But nowhere do they say that there was actual pogroms that were called upon by the Organization of Ukrainian Nationals. Now, there are a number of problems with these documents. Mr. Himka is about to present to you three such documents. And they're interesting. I've seen those documents. They come from Mr. Tsarennik's research in Soviet archives. Mr. Tsarennik accepted those and other documents at face value. He did absolutely no forensic analysis, absolutely nothing. He took a document, all right? He didn't search for a witness who could identify and authenticate that document, and he simply submitted it as if it were a legitimate document. Now, in a court of law, those documents would never be admitted into evidence. Consequently, what is now amongst those documents, there are documents which are clear forgeries. There is an alleged autobiography written by Yaroslav Stichko, which his own wife stated after she saw that that is not his signature. Yet Mr. Tsarennik, in his article with Mr. Berhov, goes on to say, well, she may deny that that's his signature, but we know better. But even Mr. Himka today will probably acknowledge that that document is a fabrication. All right. So my suggestion is that in as much as we've been preparing for today's discussion for some time, Mr. Himka has eight documents or exhibits that he would like to submit into evidence, all right, or into this discussion. Let him do so. I would assume that since he's had all this time to prepare for it, this is the best evidence that he can come up with. And I'm telling you beforehand, a priori, that these documents have no authentication, no identification, nor have they been ever forensically tested.
There's many more things that Mr. Lisinski said that, you know, deserve some comment before I get to the documents. It's not true that I don't quote the April 1941 resolution to the end. I do quote it to the end, almost always. You referred, Mr. Lisinski, to Himka and his people. I should not be mixed up with what other scholars say or do. I am myself. I do not tell Marko Tsarennik what to do or Per Anders Rudling. I've been often accused of being a sort of Professor Moriarty who does everything. No, that's not the case. These are individuals with their own agendas as well. Some of them I know better, some of them I know worse. Will these documents that I'm about to show hold up in a court of law? No. Historical evidence and the judicial evidence are quite different. The kind of certainty you have to have for a court of law beyond a reasonable doubt is very different than what historians have to do, which is try to figure out what happened. And there I'm going to say right away, and I'll probably come back to this point, that if all this stuff, the evidence that I'm going to show exists, then something has to be explained. Like, then if they don't prove what I say they prove, well, what do they show then? What do they mean? How did they get there? I know about Bandera's memorandum to Hitler. It was Eugene Stachio, I believe, delivered it. I know what it said. It basically said that don't think that the Reich can establish a Ukrainian puppet state. We won't stand for that. I will point out that that was put out, that that was done before the declaration of renewal of statehood on the 30th of June, 1941. And that makes a difference because among the documents and among many other documents, you will see that already in July, they are asking for Bandera and Stetsko to be released for the recognition of Ukrainian statehood and for the victory of the German army. Mr. Tsarennik's research in Soviet archives, there are no other archives that actually have all these O-UN documents. These are captured O-UN documents. And his study, which you refer to, goes to the length of actually showing you pictures of the documents, and I've taken three from there, but they're also available elsewhere. You can go directly to the archives and see them, and not just the one archive, but the more for some of them, because the leaflets in particular were spread among various archives. Now, are all Soviet documents then falsified? Then how do we do research on the famine? Do we have to discount all those things? Do we have to discount everything we find in the SBU files? I mean, why is Mr. Vyatrovich opening them up if he doesn't think that they're genuine documents? Furthermore, all the documents, I believe all the documents that I'm just not 100% sure at the moment, because I didn't expect this kind of a line of attack, but the documents, the first three documents, are reproduced, transcribed and published in a document that was edited by, included in its editorial board, Yaroslav Dashkevich, who was definitely pro-nationalist and was arrested and served time in prison for links with AUN, and by Vasil Kuk, who was the last leader of UPA. So they accepted it, but Mr. Lozinski somehow feels that anything that comes out of a Soviet archive must be false. Well, I disagree. Now, on the autobiography of Stetskov, absolutely it's not a falsification. Absolutely. There's only one article which tries to say it's a falsification. And the main points are that it has a mistake in Stetskov's biography, but as Taras Kurilo has shown very clearly, it was not a mistake. Professor Hunchak did not know enough about the history of the AUN to realize that there were two periodicals called Ideya Ichin. And second of all, Taras Hunchak said that the language was not like Stetskov's language. But in fact, I was able to, thanks to Oras Martinovich, who called my attention to an article that Stetskov wrote in 1938 in a Canadian Ukrainian newspaper called Zhidyutstvo i My, Jewry and Us, where I found exactly the same phrases used four or five times. So I'm convinced that it is a real thing. You also look at the historical circumstances of its production, you can understand what he's saying. So I defend that. But now let's go to the documents I'd like to submit. Okay, number one is a leaflet that was posted all over Western Ukraine and in Lviv on the day of the pogrom on the 1st of July, 1941. It can be found in other archives and local archives. And it is signed by Ivan Klimil. It's composed by Ivan Klimil from the land leadership of the Ukrainian nationalists on the maternal Ukrainian lands. And it says very clearly, Znai, Moskva, Polska, Madyare, Zhidova, це твої вороги, нищ їх. No, Moscow, Poland, the Hungarians and Jewry, these are your enemies, destroy them. Also, I'll mention that these documents, which Mr. Lozinski thinks are fake, are remembered by Holocaust survivors who have never set foot near a Soviet archive. This and the next two documents I am going to discuss are from Marko Tsarinik's article in Nationalities Papers in 2011, Foes of Our Rebirth, Ukrainian Nationalist Discussions About Jews, 1929-47. And this is precisely a collection designed to give the lie to those who claim that AUN was a non-anti-Semitic. In fact, there are maybe about a dozen or so similar documents. I've only chosen three as a sample, and I believe people should read those. Number two document, an order from, again, Ivan Klimil, who was land leader of AUN, dated 31st of August, 1941. And this is an order to fellow members of AUN. На всіх домах, морах, плотах і так далі написи. Смерть москалям, полякам, жидам. І другим ворогам України. Хай живе Гітлер, хай живе німецька армія. This is 31st August 1941? Yes. On all houses, walls, fences, etc. Write these inscriptions. Death to the Muscovites, Poles, Jews, and other enemies of Ukraine. Long live Hitler. Long live the German army. Document 3. is a leaflet from mid-July 1941, printed leaflet from plenipotentiary of the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists. It says, "Треба негайно перевести реєстрацію від межування жидів від арійського населення та вживати їх до фізичної праці." We must immediately conduct a registration and a separation of Jews from the Aryan population and use them for physical labor. Unquote. Okay, number four is a German document, and it's from the Ereignismeldung, number 24, and this was a report from Einsatzgruppe C, or C. And Einsatzgruppe C was the primary killing force that eliminated Ukraine's Jews. And they report on the destruction of the Jewish population. And here's just a sample of one of their reports. I won't read it in German. "The investigations in Zolotyu have established that the Russians, before their retreat, arrested and murdered, without particular selection, altogether 700 Ukrainians. Among them, however, the entire Ukrainian intelligentsia." And this is this refers to the NKVD murders of 1941, which killed over 10,000 people. And I go back to the German document. "In reprisal for this, the militia, at the orders of the Wehrmacht, arrested several hundred Jews to be shot. The number of liquidated Jews was between 300 and 500.
Right. May I interrupt at this point? Let's talk about these four documents that you submitted, all right? Let's take the last one.
The end of them first?
Excuse me? You finished the four documents.
No, I have nine documents.
No, you have nine exhibits. You have four documents. The others are alleged testimony and pictures.
William, I would like to go through all my evidence first.
Go ahead. There are time constraints, Mr. Hinton.
Yes. I didn't take as long without that interruption. Okay, the fifth document is a testimony of Richard Rindner, a Holocaust survivor, from the 8th of September, 1944. And I'll read it just the English part. "On 1st of July, the Ukrainian militia was seizing Jews on the streets, took them to various assembly points where they were mercilessly beaten." And this is from the archive of the Jewish Historical Institute in Warsaw. That follows document six, the testimony, or exhibit six, testimony of Yanisław Korczeński from 1945, I believe. The day after the entrance of the Germans into Lviv, I saw a group of Ukrainians with yellow and blue armbands conducting a group of Jews, women and men, about 70 persons, to the prison on Zamarstynia Street. As they led them, they beat them with clubs, and at the gate stood several Ukrainians who beat all those who went in." Also from the archive of the Jewish Historical Institute. Number seven is a photograph of a kneeling woman with her hands up. We know from numerous testimonies and memoirs that Jews were forced to crawl on their knees, to walk on their knees with their hands up, some distance. And you can see very clearly a militia man beside her, and that comes from Witold Mendikowski's book of Cieniu Gigantów, and he doesn't say his source, but he works at Yad Vashem. Number eight is a still from a film showing Jews exhuming and cleaning corpses from Brigidki prison. A militia man uses his baton to make a Jewish man move faster. And this is from the film archive of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. And number nine, the last picture I'd like to use, and this has been a subject of considerable debate, but I think things have clarified a lot more now. This is Ivan Volishin. You can see his Ukrainian militia identification. It exists in the state archives of Lviv Oblast. There are eight such identifications in the state archives of Lviv Oblast. And the pictures of the Lviv pogrom, which I put next to it, are from the Wiener Library in London. His identification in the militia was issued 21st of July, 1941, but he actually entered the militia on 3rd of July. He was part of a special investigative department in the militia, that seems to have been connected with our own security service. He was not in the militia during the pogrom, but he was clearly an influential person who later joined the militia, and we don't know when he joined the special task force of the OUN. The initial research for this composite photograph was conducted by Professor Jeffrey Birds of Northeastern University. And that's it.
Okay. All right. Let me suggest the following, that in his essay on the Lviv pogrom, Mr. Zahibka specifically refers to the date of July 1st, when he accuses the OUN, because the accused here by Mr. Himka is not the auxiliary militia or even the Ukrainian militia, but the accused is the OUN. So what you need to do is you need to connect the dots. You need to show, A, that the Ukrainian militia, which acted on July 1st, was one that was put together by the OUN. That's the first point. Your major problem with this is that militias were made up of the militia which existed under Soviet times. There was a Soviet militia before OUN, before the Germans, and before anybody else arrived in Lviv. Those people were in the militia that allegedly participated in a pogrom, which you allege to have taken place only on July 1st, 1941, and no other days. Subsequently, there was an auxiliary Ukrainian militia created by the Germans, and if you look at your exhibit number 8, that exhibit number 8, the ID card, is specifically in two languages, Ukrainian and German, and it is signed by a German official. That militia was not created by the OUN. That militia was created by the Germans. And the function of that militia is very clear: to gather, to follow, in other words, to keep order. And it specifies that, I'm taking one of your documents, and it specifies that they're supposed to keep order. Nowhere in any of these documents does it say that the OUN was responsible or carried out the killings. In fact, nowhere in these documents, and I'm assuming, I'm taking you at face value, these documents. Now, let's assume that they're legitimate documents, all right? Despite the fact that they haven't been tested or forensically or any other way. Let's assume that they're legitimate documents. Nowhere did they say that the Ukrainian militia executed. They gathered, they put the Jews together. And nowhere does it say that the initial Ukrainian militia, the one that allegedly perpetrated the pogrom of July 1st, was put together by OUN. And in fact, in your article, in your essay, you acknowledge that fact, that it doesn't say that, but you say, well, it was probably that way. Now, let's talk briefly about eyewitness testimony. Interestingly enough, the two that you do, let's go, just, I apologize for this. I'm going to go back to the German document. The German document talks about militia. It doesn't even say what type of militia. It talks about the fact that there were Ukrainians murdered by the Soviets. But when it talks about militia, it doesn't even mention the word Ukrainian. Now, what is very important here, all right, are eyewitness testimony, because eyewitness testimony can identify the documents, but these documents are not identified by eyewitness testimony. Mr. Himka offers two pieces of testimony. One, and these are both taken in, one in 1944, one in 1940, I believe subsequently, they are taken by the Institute, the Jewish Historical Institute, which was in Poland. Now, let's consider there is an old saying amongst attorneys, not only among my profession, but in general, he lied like an eyewitness.
Really, that's a Russian saying. Excuse me. That's a Russian saying as well.
Eyewitnesses who are called upon to testify as to a specific topic. Can you imagine if you're called in by the Institute to give eyewitness testimony about the Holocaust and you are Jewish, all right? You not only tell what you know, but you also tell what you don't know. You embellish because you want to please the people who are taking your testimony. And interestingly enough, in this particular instance, and Mr. Himko will acknowledge this as well, that in the Institute, the Historical Institute, the people who were taking the testimony were instructed not to interfere, even if there was anything in the testimony that was incredible and the witness was incredulous, all right? That you are not to interfere. You're supposed to simply take down what they're saying. Now, let's take the first testimony. This testimony is only relevant if it applies to July 1st. But surprisingly enough, between July 1st and the document itself and reference to the militia, there are at least four words which Mr. Himka conveniently omitted. There is no evidence to show that the militia actually acted on July 1st because there's no connection with it. And the second document, interestingly enough, this witness is a phenomenal witness because this witness, Yanislav Kurczynski, says the day after the entrance of the Germans into Lviv, I saw how a group of Ukrainians with yellow and blue armbands conducted a group of Jews, women, and men, about 70 persons, to the prison on Zamartynu Street. As they led them, they beat them with clubs, and at the gate stood several Ukrainians who beat all those who went in. All right? Now, clearly, the Germans had to be involved in this. Okay? He's giving testimony about allegedly what he saw. But there is no opportunity to ask him to cross-examine this witness. This is a wonderful opportunity. I don't know whether you gentlemen are familiar with memoirs. I, in particular, read memoirs written by older Ukrainians. And they are some of the biggest heroes, given the fact that many have died and nobody remembers or nobody knows what actually took place. All right? Where eyewitnesses become, they add unimaginable things into their testimony. The problem is that maybe this is true, but there's no opportunity. Maybe it's not. And you cannot condemn even the militia. They don't even mention the O'un, so it's completely irrelevant as far as our discussion is concerned. But they talk about the militia, but even that is suspect because they can't be cross-examined. Photographs. No identification. Let's take photograph number one. No identification. When this photograph was taken, who these people are, who saw this, all right? This could have been staged in Kinostudia Dozhenka, for all I know. In the case of photographs, you have to have chain of custody. You have to establish that. You have to identify, none of which is being done by Mr. Himka. Jeffrey Burns is another one who does the same thing, just accepts photos. The same applies to the shot from the film. And frankly speaking, I'm not denying that the militia, the auxiliary militia, may have been involved in forcing Jews to exhume the bodies of those Poles and Ukrainians who had been murdered by the Soviets. I'm not doubting that, but I'm saying that even this has no authentication or identification. And finally, with all due respect, Professor, Coalition is a joke, all right? Because coalition, you're using coalition to show his participation in the pogrom of July 1st, yet his card isn't issued until July 23rd or 24th, and the card says that he became a policeman on July the 3rd. And this is not the so-called Stichwahr militia. This is the so-called German auxiliary militia. And once again, I'm not defending the German auxiliary militia. Consequently, with all due respect, your evidence may be evidence had it been authenticated, all right? And furthermore, its biggest problem, it doesn't connect the OUN with the militia. And still furthermore, it doesn't allege that the militia perpetrated killings. It only suggests that the militia picked up the Jews and brought them together, which I'm not denying. I'm just suggesting that it was not at any time under the control of the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists.
Sure, I'll start with the connection. I tried to limit the documents. This was like, I don't know, 1%, 2% of the kind of stuff that's out there. But I've written elsewhere, and historians of OUN know that the militia was founded on the 30th of June by the OUN. They were recruited at St. George's Cathedral and at the Platz there, at the square. On the 3rd of July, it's also known, it's been known for a very long time, that the militia was put under the command of the German Sicherheitsdienst, the security service, basically to work with the Einsatzgruppe. The best authority I can imagine that the militia was with the OUN is that if you read the memoirs you'd like to read memoirs of old Ukrainians, you might read the memoirs of Yaroslav Stetsko on the 30th of June, and then he talks about how a few days later the Germans were going to not recognize Ukrainian statehood. And he says, what forces did we have at our disposal? All we had was our militia. Okay? So, it's all there. You can connect it very easily. In history, we don't do a forensic analysis of every document we use, or no history would ever be written. As I said, the rules of law and the rules of history are really quite different. There was no Ukrainian auxiliary militia. There was a Ukrainian auxiliary police, and that was founded later. The militia was founded on the 30th. Actually, the first militia was founded, I believe, on the 25th or 27th of June on the way to Lviv. And then that first militia that's founded, and again, this is a Stetsko. Stetsko founds it. They found it in order to remove the Jews in a certain locality. It's true, Ukrainian militia did not do much of the execution. They occasionally killed people with shovels or would beat people to death, that kind of thing. But it's small numbers. Usually what they did is they rounded up Jews for the Germans to shoot or to send to concentration camps. But that's later. I've got two interesting reports from Melnikait, who was in Lviv at that time. And these were given to me by Miron Momrek, who is an archivist in Canada. And he found them not in the Soviet archive, but in the National Archives of Canada, where former Melnikites had given some of their material. But there are two interesting reports. One says that the pogrom, which occurred, he considered the demonstration of Polish national activity. So he considered the Poles were involved in the pogrom, mainly. I'll come back to that. And the second thing he said was that the militia was made up of diversante. And my friend Miron Momrek sent that to me. in order to show me that it wasn't the Bandurites who were in the militia, but it was Diversante. What he doesn't know is the Melnikites referred to the Bandurites as Diversante at this time. That was their terminology for them. As to the people who took part in the pogrom, probably a mix of Ukrainians and Poles. Although how many Poles would be out on the streets when the Ukrainian militia was out doing things, I don't know. But we have some because we have Polish eyewitnesses who are obviously there on the scene. We don't, you know, no one took a census of who was there in the crowd encouraging people on. First, I want to go back to the eyewitness testimony too. These are not eyewitnesses in the court of law. What happened is right after the war, with the immense destruction of the Jewish population, not the Jewish Historical Institute, which now houses the papers, but the Central Jewish Historical Commission, I believe it was called, just got as many stories as they could. And they did it in 44, 45, and they continued. However, they're not the only people who collected them. And Steven Spielberg collected a whole bunch as well in the 70s through the early 90s. And they tell the same kinds of stories. So, and there are also published books from all over. There's even a book in Spanish from a woman who emigrated after the war to Spain, and she wrote an account of the Livio pogrom. And it's all the same kind of thing. So I would say that Mr. Luzinski has the task of trying to figure out why do all these archives from all these different places show and indicate exactly the same thing. As to the coalition document, I only want to say is, well, then what's your explanation for that? Why is this guy active in the pogroms and then very soon after in the militia and in a special investigative department within the militia, probably connected with the Poland Security Service? You know, my task, I bring these all together. Markot Sarenix brought them all together. Grzegorz Rosalinski Liebe wrote a biography of Bandera where many things are cited.
May I add something to this? There was the Soviets established a special commission following World War II to deal with the crimes that were perpetrated in Lviv Oblast. They came down with a report. In that report, they even provided names of perps. There isn't a single OUN leader, nor is OUN on that list. Soviet prosecutor, procurator, Roman Rudenko, in 1946, submitted these findings to the Nuremberg Tribunal. These findings were a part of the Nuremberg record. Don't you think that had OUN been guilty of war crimes, don't you think that a friend of theirs, like Soviet procurator Roman Rudenko, would have insisted that they be charged and punished, or maybe not executed, but punished? There isn't a single reference to them. Now, with all due respect to your scholarship, Professor, which, frankly speaking, I'm not impressed by, the seminal work on the destruction of the European Jews was done in three editions and three volumes by Raoul Helberg. You quote him in defining what a pogrom was. There is no one better than Raoul Helberg. There is no one more of an expert. In his entire three volumes, he mentions the OUN, the Organizacja Ukraińskich Nacjonalistów, one time and never in connection with any atrocity or any pogrom. Eyewitness accounts, 1,000-page book written by Martin Gilbert. He collected numerous testimony, also coming up short of any indictment or even accusation against the OUN. In fact, Interestingly enough, Raoul Hilberg relied on German documents primarily. And he, to a large degree, he poo-pooed eyewitness testimony. But he relied on German documents. And in one of his documents, he specifically says how the Germans bemoaned the fact that Ukrainians were not cooperative, that Ukrainians were not doing their part in the extermination of Jews. This is coming from, with all due respect, Professor, a scholar on the Holocaust who is more established and more renowned than you. Yet you quote Hilberg in your paper one time only in defining what a pogrom is. All right? That's it. And yet you contort that definition. Because pogroms, according to Raoul Hilberg, are an action, sporadic action, that is done by the spinota, by the society where the local population is found. Here you're suggesting that the Lviv pogrom was perpetrated essentially by people who were coming from Kharkov. Kharkov, yes, because the Otwin leadership was coming from Krakow, rather.
Krakow.
Sorry, Kharkov is a Russian version of Kharkiv, right? Krakow. That's where they were coming from, all right? And then they used, apparently, the local personnel. Yet, that's not a pogrom. In any event, no one supports that version of the facts. Neither Raoul Hilberg, neither Martin Gilbert, neither the Special Soviet Commission, even Procurator Rudenko didn't agree with you.
First, on the Soviet Commission, I've seen the document often quoted, and Stepan Bandera likes to quote it, about the who's responsible for the violence for war crimes in Lviv. And usually, if you look at that, you can discover that most of them are Germans. Almost all of them are Germans. Hans Frank is on there, although Hans Frank did not gain jurisdiction over District Galician until in August, while the pogrom occurred in July. And if you look at that commission, it has a number of levels. So one level is the local level. At the most local level, they do interviews and things like that. Then they go up to the oblast level, and then they go up to the Republican level, and then they go to the all-Soviet level. What you see is the all-Soviet level. If you look at the investigations that lead up to it on the more local levels, you will find lots and lots of our own people in them. Yes, these documents are available. Second of all, about that document, I'll say this, that the Soviets at this time for Nuremberg were not interested in revealing anything about collaboration in their own territory. They did not do that until much later. And that is because they were going to present Germany with a bill. Every murder was the Germans and their helpers. But it was always ascribed to the Germans. I have a great case in the town of Hrimaljo, where the Viking, the Waffen-SS division Viking, and the Oun collaborated on murdering a great number of Jewish inhabitants in the town of Hrimaljo. And in the Soviet documentation of this pogrom, they claim that a certain Landau was involved in it. But in fact, that person was in a hospital and not even had reached Hrimaljo at that point in his career. So, the Soviet commissions have to be taken in context. It's not a question of forensics, it's a question of putting things together. As for Raoul Hilberg, I've read his book. He was inspiring me right at the beginning of my studies of this. Actually, my supervisor made me read it when I was, in the 60s, late 60s. It had been written in 1961. But
there are three editions.
Yeah, I know.
It was subsequently updated.
Yeah,
in 1983, and then again in 2003.
You don't have to tell me the basics of Holocaust research. I actually know them. And as for Hilberg, he worked with the German documents, which gave him a German view of the Holocaust. But he didn't know any East European languages, and he didn't know much about East European history. He has that document which you mentioned about the how difficult it is to get the Ukrainians riled up, and that refers to Zhytomyr, where there was no local OUN.
It does not.
It does.
It refers to Zakhidna Ukraina.
Read it again. It's from Zhytomyr.
Yeah, it's specific. I read it again after your interview previously.
Yeah, and Hilberg's method of not using eyewitnesses was something that was very common in the early 60s. Hannah Arendt also wouldn't use eyewitness testimony or rely on it. They felt that only the German documents told the story, but that's simply not true. And I think that the big change in Holocaust research has been in incorporating eyewitness accounts to figure out what happened, because the German documents are not interested in certain things. They are a source, not the full source. So that's how I would respond to this. First of all, I want to say that many developed nations, mature nations, have dealt with what they've done wrong in the past. So, for example, the Germans are really among the leading Holocaust scholars today. They weren't for a long time, but they've wrapped their head around it, and now they have the very best research on the Holocaust. And in their public face, they try to do everything possible to erase that sad chapter of their history. The United States has reconciled itself to the fact that slavery was an evil. And so, for instance, recently on the $20 United States bill, Harriet Tubman, who is a person who opposed slavery and who helped to free many slaves, has now been put on a bill. So it's not so unusual. On the case of the Poles, I'll say that the Poles are a divided society, sort of like the Ukrainians in some ways. There are those who welcomed the research of Jan Gross, which showed what Poland was like during the wartime vis-a-vis the Jews. And there were others who just went into a nationalist denial, similar to the kinds you can find in other East European nations. As for the Ukrainians, you'll find really divided views in Polish society. Right now, Ukrainian stock is low. And partially, it's been suggested by Wasyl Rusewicz that this is owing to the fixation of post-Maidan Ukraine with the Banderite heritage. But from what I see of Poland, there are those who are pro-Ukrainian, who want to hush up any kind of Ukrainian crimes against the Poles. And this would be people like Adam Michnik, Gazeta Wyborcza, and various liberals who were in the previous government. There are other Polish scholars who are, I would say, quite balanced in their judgment of Ukrainian history. You can find people like Grzegorz Motyka and others who just try to find out what went on. And you can find Polish nationalists, virulent Polish nationalists, who are anti-Ukrainian. You have as well people who are the descendants of the ethnic cleansing in Volhynia, and they tend to be, I wouldn't say anti-Ukrainian, because they're not, but they feel very frustrated by the presentation of Ukrainian nationalists as heroes. So Poland is different, and it's like many societies, it's divided over these issues. Even in Germany, there are neo-fascist parties, and even in the United States, there are racist and white supremacist parties. So I don't think Ukraine, by dealing with its own history, will be so unusual. I think a big difference here is that it's very rare, let's say, that the Germans will not make Himmler a hero. They won't have a Himmler Plots. And then the opposite example is Russia. There's no real realization of Russia and its minority policies. They have no thinking along that line. I don't want to be like them. What I think about Ukrainians is Ukrainians should just do whatever is right. They should be intellectually right on top. There's no reason they shouldn't be. They should be talented in culture. They should have good history. They should put all this aside. But above all, they shouldn't be glorifying these people. So that's where I stand on that. I hope that answers your question.
If I may, I think that there is a double standard. Yakov Blake is a friend of mine, but the double standard in not glorifying Jewish criminals, of course, but there is a glorification of Jews who perpetrated crimes. For example, in the state of Israel, Menachem Begin, some of the leadership in Israel. And the reason for that is, for example, in the United States, stresses the fact that dropping a bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki was a good thing because it essentially saved many American lives. At the same time, there was an awful lot of collateral damage to the Japanese because of the dropping of these bombs. And the reason why America has never had to account for this is because America has been victorious in most wars, all right, except perhaps for the Vietnam War. On the other hand, in Ukraine, I think the situation is distinct because Ukraine has always been under an occupier. For example, if we were to address the walling situation, you can go, I don't know where to begin the line of retaliatory action, all right? Whether you begin it from Khmelnytsky's time and ended on Akcija Wisla in 1947, and in the middle, in between somewhere is the Volinska Akcija, if you considered that it was a genocide, all right? But there were retaliatory actions on the part of all nations. But the fact of the matter is that if you take the net result, aside from the Chinese, who died under Mao's Cultural Revolution, no one suffered more or had more victims during the 20th century than the Ukrainians. This isn't coming from me. This is coming from Norman Davies, who was a reputable actually outstanding historian professor, and who had, if I'm not mistaken, a Polish wife who probably would have inclined him to stress that the Polish people lost an awful lot of people as well. But because of our tragic history, I think we tend to be defensive. But in the case of, because we never controlled our own circumstances. But in the case of looking for demons, in my opinion, O'un Upa would never even come up as a demon were it not for Soviet propaganda, disinformation, and the need for the Holocaust industry to find new demons because they had run out of demons. Now, Soviet propaganda and forgery, I didn't spend any time on that. But you will all remember the John Demjanjuk case, all right? The documents that were forged by the Soviets and submitted to the Office of Special Investigations. I have with me a deposition that was taken in these war crime cases that went on in the United States, where the United States actually acceded to taking depositions of Soviet witnesses before a Soviet procurator. There were four Soviet procurators sitting around this poor witness and he was supposed to deliver the facts, you know, and the Americans took it in because they had an agenda. The agenda was to denaturalize, in this case, whoever it was, whether it was Kozy or Demjanjuk. The Soviets were notorious for forgeries. In fact, the we were referring to the Zhikepis, the autobiography of Yaroslav Stichko Tserennik, didn't unearth this document. This document was unearthed in 1970, and it was used by a notorious Soviet agent, Michael Hanushak, a progressive, who published it in a book called Lest We Forget, as a diatribe against Yaroslav Stichko and the Ukrainian nationalists. And that's why, because the Soviets since day one, and they were in fact since OUN was created in 1929, in the newspapers published articles against OUN calling them fascists, even though OUN couldn't have been fascist because they were a national liberation struggle, not setting up any form of government, all right? But from the very beginning, the Soviets became involved in disparaging OUN UPA. For us, OUN UPA are heroes, all right? And I'm sure that there were members of OUN and UPA who perpetrated crimes. But as a general group, as an organization, as a movement, all right, they were struggling for Ukrainian independence. Sure, they may have been collateral damage, but it was not intentional collateral damage. There was no aim at any time, either on the part of OUN or UPA, to be a part of the final solution. All right? And they are heroes for us. And unfortunately, what Mr. Himka, and I, with all due respect, I firmly believe that it's because he received money for it and because of his past. He was always an enemy of OUN UPA. He was always an enemy of OUN UPA. He was a progressive. He had his own agenda, all right? And frankly speaking, he was a perfect candidate. If I was a Holocaust industry, I would have conscripted him as well.
Oh, just so you guys know, no one has sponsored this video, okay? I'm in the hole for this. Maybe somebody will come through in a couple of days. I don't know. Final question. Mr. Luzinski, you made a really persuasive comment. You said the Ukrainians, you spoke about the Herculean task that Volodymyr Virtovich is facing, and the Ukrainians should be writing their own history. And at the same time, I was moved by what Mr. Himka said. I want clarity. I want truth. I want a comprehensive, sophisticated Ukrainian history that doesn't exclude any documents.
Right, but the fact of the matter is that there were many Soviet documents that were forgeries. And they were planted amongst documents that were legitimate documents. And the only way to determine them, I understand that forensic testing is an expensive proposition, but there are certain witnesses. Mr. Himka mentions that when he sent, I believe, his wife to Lviv to get accusatory remarks against the OUN from Ukrainians who reside in Lviv, she was unable to do so. And perhaps I'm not suggesting that there weren't any. I'm just suggesting that they were reticent in doing that because they were Ukrainian. But there is absolutely no doubt that the Soviets were masters in forging documents. They had entire laboratories, and they spent an awful lot of money on this information. And you can't simply accept everything Soviet as being real.
The document you mentioned in 1946 by Roman Rudenko, you don't think that kind of falls into the area? You think that's authentic?
Well, it's a declaration against interest.
Yeah, that's the point.
Which is he declared something. In other words, he made his case before Nuremberg. It would have been in his interest to impugn the OUN and the UPA. And he failed to do so. Why? Because he was friends with them? No. It was a declaration against interest.
We can conclude on that because you folks have been so generous.
I'm sorry, but I have to.
Yeah, you folks have been so generous. I want to thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very kindly both again. Thank you very much.
Take care.
Bye-bye.